One of the things that I've always wondered, Nancy, is you and others became biologists. You are a renowned biologist. You're a member of the National Academy of Sciences. You got into the field when the field was truly being reinvented, and you were part of that revolution. But I always wonder whether the choice of field, the biology, being in the midst of that incredible rate of change, had something to do with the experience of your development as an academician, as a woman in science, and also at MIT, because of the competitive nature of the place, the renowned nature of the place. What do you think?
I think when I was young, well, first of all, I discovered molecular biology as an undergraduate at Harvard. I was a junior, and I was trying to figure out what to do with my life. And I thought maybe medical school. So I needed to take a biology class, and I took the class. I was a junior, it was 1963. And one of the professors teaching the class was James D. Watson, who had discovered the structure of DNA 10 years earlier. You know, I walked into that class from one person and I came out a different person. And I knew what I wanted to do with the rest of my life. And it really was a transformative moment, hour. And so I went and worked in Watson's lab, and Watson encouraged me to become a scientist. So I was starting at the top, you know, so to speak. And so I was aware that there was discrimination going on. The women's liberation movement came along actually after that, around that time, after that, and civil rights, affirmative action. So I was aware of that. But for me, I was in my little cocoon there, protected by Jim Watson as a student and encouraged to become a scientist. So I didn't really think about it. I saw that it was very competitive. I saw how these men were treating each other. And I thought, whoa, that would be a rough thing to do. I don't know if I could do that. And then, of course, I found myself in the situation. But I didn't attribute it to being a woman. I didn't understand the distinction between the competitiveness of the science and what it meant to put a woman into that situation at that moment in time.
You all of a sudden realized that things were not clicking for you. And you attributed it, this is a gender issue. And that's a big step, a big step. What prepared you, or did anything prepare you, to take that mantle of leadership, to say, I'm going to do something about it? And what made you feel, not only I'm going to do something about it, but I can do something about it?
I wish I had felt the way you just described. I wish I'd say, I can do this. But that, you know, really, the whole thing was kind of accidental. Not accidental, it was deliberate. But it was an act, I think, of desperation, honestly. Because I had had a difficult time at MIT, really almost from the beginning. And what I discovered, took 15 years, was that when a woman made a discovery, she and her discovery were undervalued relative to if a man had made that same discovery. It was almost unbelievable that this could be true, but I came to see that it was true. And the hardest thing of all is to say it's true of yourself. So it took another 5 years, so it took 20 years before I realized this was also what my problem was. This was why I was having such a hard time. I didn't have the same resources. I didn't have the same space. I was excluded from this, not invited to be part of that. And I finally really believed that it was because I was a woman. And it was a, you know, moment, an aha moment. It took 20 years to realize it and accept it. And part of it also, I think, because we think science is a meritocracy. So if you're really good enough, it shouldn't even matter if you're being discriminated against. You should be able to overcome it. And that's just not true. So I was desperate. And so I finally, tried to tell my local administrators. They didn't know what I was talking about, and I couldn't blame them because it had taken me 20 years to figure it out myself. And then I sat down and wrote a letter to the president of MIT saying, dear sir, you know, I've discovered this terrible problem, and maybe you'd like to fix it. You know, so I thought I'd better run it by somebody else, make sure it was polite and convincing. So I asked my colleague, Mary Lou Pardue, who I barely knew, but who I had really admired. She was the first woman in science at MIT to be elected to the National Academy. I asked her to read the letter just to make sure it was polite. And she read the letter, and she said she wanted to sign the letter. And she thought we should go and see the president because she agreed with everything I said. So I went from being alone, thinking I was the only person who understood the problem, and nobody else would ever really understand it, suddenly I wasn't alone. I had an ally. And I think, you know, we looked at each other and we said, wow, you agree, we agree. And you knew when you weren't alone, there were two of you, and one of them was a member of the National Academy already, you had power. Mm-hmm. And people might actually be able to hear you. And then we thought, wow, if there were more women, we'd have more power. So why don't we go and see if we can, if other women agree with us. And so we, you know, collected a list of all the tenured women in the School of Science, and discovered there were only 15 of them. So it wasn't going to be hard to find out what they thought. So we went around and talked to them. And incredibly, all but one of the women, ultimately there were 17, because there were two joint appointments in engineering. There were 17 people, and 16 of them wanted to join an effort to address this problem. This is where the MIT story really resides, right there.
Did you find at any point that conversation with your colleagues struck them as strange initially? In other words, did any of them react like, really, this has been happening?
Yes, we did. That's so interesting. Yes, we did. And I can still remember each woman as we went to speak to them. I can still see the setting, the person, their face, how they responded, the conversations. Really, the most surprising thing was that a number of the women said, do you have anything I can sign? Right away, instantly, that's what they wanted to sign on. But then there was, I remember one woman who said, I don't know if it's discrimination, but if it doesn't change, I can't take this any longer. And I realized if I hadn't spent 15, 20 years observing other women and how they were treated, I would not have understood it. And so I think in some fields, a woman, there were so few women, they never saw any other women. Mm-hmm. For me, the moment that I realized that I too had been discriminated was probably one of the two or three low points of the whole thing. I think it's better to think it's your own fault than it is to feel you were discriminated against. You thought you were part of this enterprise, but you really never really were.
Was there a point where you said, I'm giving up, I can't do this, even after you got going with the support of all your colleagues?
No. From that moment on, I was determined to work with these women and see if we could do something about it. It was the moment before that. It was the last straw moment when I knew I couldn't keep working that way, because this kind of discrimination is very subtle, almost invisible. People don't know about it. You can't explain it. And any one incident by itself, you might just brush it off and say, well, I was a difficult person, or it's the circumstances. Mm-hmm. So there's nothing you can do to fix it. And it's one after another. So you fix one problem, and 6 months later, you've got another problem. I spent half my time trying to fix problems that arose, which I now then realized these things were happening because I was a woman. Mm-hmm. And they really were. And they were happening to other women, and they were happening to me, and they were making this job harder than it needed to be. I mean, it was just ridiculous. And, you know, one was about space, and I had to prove I had less space. I mean, a five-year-old child could have walked through the labs and said, you have less space. I took a tape measure and went around the building and measured every room in the building to prove I had less space. You know, okay, I got to get the data. Well, this is a lot of time and ridiculous silliness.
What was that moment when you really reached the point that they got it?
Because it turned out so well. We tend to think of it as, oh, we raised our hand, said there's a problem here, and MIT said, oh, thank you for pointing it out, we'll fix it right away.
Not quite that way.
it doesn't work that way. And this is where the group, without the group, it could not have happened. And every one of those women was essential to what we did. And the power was in the group, and the fact that we created consensus. We took consensus mm-hmm. on every step and every point. So they knew it was essentially all their tenured women faculty felt this way. That was what made it possible to take on MIT. But would they respond? It very much depended on the particular individuals, I believe, who were in positions of power who responded. And without those individuals, I think it could have gone any which way. It could have ended in a disaster. It could have ended in nothing. It could have sputtered out. And I felt if I went to work and I wasn't kind of tense all day long, I probably hadn't accomplished anything that day. It was a feeling of pushing against not because of bad will, but because of how difficult the situation was for the administration.
You said something that I want to emphasize and also maybe explore a little bit, because it certainly agrees with my thinking. Leadership, change, individuals that propel and make change. People like you taking this class on and doing it. People, like you said, at MIT at the moment, it is a convergence of moment and people. And if that convergence is not there, it could go in a different way. It's just a classic chance and necessity. Things are almost not accidental, but if there isn't that convergence of in people inclined to do something, it could have been really bad.
Really bad. Disaster. The turning point was when the women, after careful discussion of how to proceed, decided to approach the Dean of Science, who was Bob Bergineau. And he was away for the summer, and we were waiting for him to come back, and we wrote him a letter and said we wanted to present you with a problem. And he came back and met with women from our group, and we explained it to him, and he referred to it as a moment of a transformation moment for him. And he totally saw what was happening. Mm-hmm. He just suddenly realized, oh my goodness, he knew these women, knew them individually, thought their problems that they might have had were individual problems in their particular circumstance, department, whatever. And suddenly he saw, no, it was a problem of women at MIT. And he became the big supporter of the women. And that was
the moment.
The moment, yeah. If I hadn't lived it, I don't know if I would have understood it myself. You know, the women's liberation movement had taken place, of course, before this started. And some of those women who were very radical in my generation, I didn't really know what they were talking about. And those people said, well, these women from MIT, you know, these Johnny-come-latelys, what's the big deal about the MIT report? We were saying this 20 years ago. I didn't understand what they were saying. I thought it had been solved, these problems for women, by the Civil Rights Act, affirmative action laws, and so forth. I had to live it to come to understand it, and I could see why other people would not understand it. And that's where I think, you know, if it hadn't been for the solidarity of that group of women, how would you explain this? Individually, some people had tried to explain it, but nobody could really hear what they were saying.
And you mentioned something which I think is also very important, the power of that group wasn't only founded on the fact that you were right, but also was founded on the fact that you stood tall in your fields.
Yeah.
The all of you, that set of individuals are extraordinary people. So there's a certain ability to do things, respect. People could not ignore you.
But they could. That was the amazing part of it. I think people think, well, they must not have been good enough because we all believed it was a meritocracy. But those women, thank you for bringing this up, Rafael. I mean, four of them won the U.S. National Medal of Science. Most of them are members of the National Academy. So these were exceptional women. But that's not how they were seen within their own workplace.
You must feel tremendously accomplished and satisfied because the change has been dramatic. Unquestionably, and I think your group achieved something that frankly many would have not have thought possible, and it has changed fast. If you look at the leadership of MIT, but if you look at the leadership of universities, top universities across the country, women play a major role. Anything else you want to add to this conversation?
Well, I found myself in this role by accident, really. And but I through it, I met extraordinary people. You were one of them, actually, and had this experience. I just wanted to be a scientist. And so people often ask me, you know, are you glad you did this? Well, it was life-changing and so forth. It had to be done. I think my generation of women found ourselves in this position, so we got together and worked on it. It was an extraordinary experience. I just wanted to be a scientist. And that was the passion, the true passion of my life. And everything I did was to try to open it up so other people who had that passion would have an easier time. Yeah, I wish that it were all solved. I wish that people who just want to be scientists could do so. And I wish that it was, we had been able to complete the job. But I realize it's a much bigger challenge than I had ever imagined.
We're certainly a lot closer because of you and the people like those that work with you. So thank you very much. It's really wonderful to be with you again. Thank you.
Wonderful to see you again.